listen to Taylor Swift?
No. Girl, I am like whiter than you.
Was it hard to grow up in the suburbs? It must have been really boring with no police activity or anything.
Your hair is amazing. Oh, you know, it's kind of like my golden retriever. It's so limp and lifeless. Like, how do you do that?
Oh, wow.
Your name is so easy to spell and pronounce. Was it like really easy to get a job?
Check out these photos of me volunteering at an orphanage in Europe.
Cool.
Those little white boys and girls, they were so inspiring.
Oh, wow. No, you don't sound like a dumb hick at all. That's so cool.
You are so pretty for a white girl.
It's really sad when Romney lost, huh? Good old Mitt. Couldn't do it. Could not do it.
You are dating a white guy. Does he have like a really tiny penis?
Oh, you must listen to that rural music, right?
You know who you look just like.
Who? Jennifer Lawrence.
So we just saw Titanic. How are you dealing? I had no idea your people had it so hard.
Your skin is so pale. Can I touch it?
Wow.
You know, I was just talking about that with my friend Jeremy. He's white too.
I don't even think of you as white. I don't. I really don't.
Wow. So you have to wear sunscreen? That is so crazy.
Hey, I'm from out of town. Can you help me find some meth? What do you mean you don't listen to Macklemore? You're white.
I've always heard that white girls are like super boring in bed.
Oh, hey.
Yo.
What's
up, my crack?
Whoa.
Oh, no, man, it's cool. You know, I can say it. My girlfriend's white.
Yeah, not cool, man.
Oh, okay. My bad, Daniel. My bad.
It's crack.
Umbrella. She's up.
What is good, my people? We are live back again with another episode of The Forecast. Now, we are in a time where more and more of us are getting on code. And the truth is, we've been on code more than people want us to believe. Because you can see, when we start getting on the same page, the rest of the world fears that. And everybody got something to say about our struggle. But what people say about us is irrelevant. The only people that are going to get us out of this situation is us. So much of our history has been destroyed, and people want us to forget about the history that we do know. But they expect us to get over something that we're still going through right now. And as much as people try to stop us, we can't stop until we're in control of our own institutions, until we're in control of our own schools, in control of the curriculum and what goes on in the kids' minds. We can't stop until we're back in control of our own economy, which is a problem for everybody else, but it doesn't matter. The fact that we have to rely on another group for our food is a problem. We can't stop until we build institutions designed to protect us. These people take our tax money and force us to pay for our own oppression. They force us to pay for the cops that are there to keep us in line. We have to sponsor a justice system that doesn't even value our lives. But then people turn around and tell us to lift ourselves up by our bootstraps. But what they don't tell you is black people in America are the only ones who have ever lifted themselves up by their bootstraps. Every other group needed help from the government to even build their own middle class. The white middle class was built off of government assistance. And the less government assistance there is, the more the white middle class starts to go away. Black people created wealth on their own because they had no other choice. And you know what? We still don't have a choice. White people didn't even want to take their money back then, so they had no other choice but to spend it with each other. And they built successful communities, but America saw that as a threat, so they destroyed them. That's why we can't stop until we build institutions that'll protect ourselves and punish people for harming us. There's been so many Holocausts against us in America, and most of them have been covered up or hidden in history. Down in Arkansas, back in 1959, 21 black boys were burnt to death in what was called the Secret Holocaust of 1959 in Arkansas.
In 1959, 21 African-American boys died in a school fire in Wrightsville. Now, decades later, you won't find a grave marker for them, nor will you find an official cause of the fire. It's a story possibly unknown or forgotten by many, but it's a chapter in history that's far from being closed.
For the last five decades, every year has been 1959 for Frank Lawrence. For the majority of his life, Lawrence has been trying to solve one of Arkansas's greatest mysteries.
Nobody ever knew it existed because of the ability of the state of Arkansas to do such a fantastic job at covering it up.
March 5th, 1959, 69 African-American boys, ages 13 to 17, including Lawrence's 15-year-old brother, Lindsey Cross, were padlocked into their dormitory for the night at the Negro Boys Industrial School in Wrightsville. Around 4 a.m., a fire mysteriously ignited, forcing the boys to fight and claw their way out of the burning building.
But it was a carefully calculated murder that involved 21 boys, but it was designed to kill all 69 that were housed inside of this dormitory.
Lawrence's life's mission has been to uncover the truth surrounding what he calls Arkansas's secret Holocaust, which coincidentally is also the focal point of author Griffin Stockley's latest work.
That most of the boys who were killed had run back to a corner of the building.
When the smoke cleared that March morning, the 21 boys that had burned to death were found piled on top of one another in the corner of the dormitory. The 48 that had survived managed to escape by prying off mesh metal screens from two windows.
If you look at the diagram, you can see that although there were a couple of doors, in fact, we know that there was nobody there to unlock the doors.
The horrific event briefly made headlines that also brought attention to the squalor and deplorable conditions the boys had been subjected to.
The boys went around in rags. They had one 30-gallon water tank for them to use to take baths.
According to Stockley, the boys in the school were committed for being orphaned, homeless, or for committing offenses described as mischief and alleged petty crimes. The school and the treatment of the children became a fiery representation of segregation within the South during the Jim Crow era.
The whole part of this is about our history of white supremacy and the way African Americans have been discriminated against historically in Arkansas. I mean, you know, it was never separate but equal. It was always unequal.
Now, almost 60 years after the horrific fire, both Lawrence and Stockley are hoping to spark a fresh look at the fire and its cause.
For the fact that it was in such deteriorated condition that probably the fire started because of the wiring.
So was it gross negligence that led to the death of the boys, or were they burned alive intentionally?
Now, in 1959, 69 black boys between the ages of 13 and 17 was in the Wrightsville Negro Boys Industrial School, which was just a juvenile jail for black boys accused of petty crimes. Some were in there for petty theft. Some were just in jail for being homeless. And in most cases, they didn't even get a fair trial. Then one night when all of them were locked in, and it just so happened that this particular night, there was no adult supervision. There was no security guard, nothing. Just a bunch of black boys that were locked in this building. When all of a sudden, a mysterious fire broke out with all of them trapped inside. Now, a lot of them were able to get out after they had to pry metal screens off the door. But 21 of these boys ended up getting burnt alive beyond recognition, all piled up in a corner. They said they were bringing out so many bodies and body parts. Of course, they were on code and they covered it up and they called it an accident. And even though the governor at the time acted upset, even though he had just went there and saw the conditions they were living in and chose not to do anything about it, but people started demanding answers, so they said they were going to investigate. They said everybody's responsible and it was everybody's fault this tragedy happened. But they didn't charge anybody with any death, and nobody was punished. It's been so many times that one of us just mysteriously comes up missing or dead, and nobody knows anything. It's just an accident and a horrible tragedy. And it's no different today. You have situations like Tamla Horsford, who mysteriously turned up dead after an adult sleepover with a bunch of white women.
This afternoon, the father of a Forsyth County woman who died at a house party says his family does not believe the sheriff's office conclusion that her death was an accident. Tamla Horsford's death has gained international attention this month. Channel 2's Mike Buchanek is live at the sheriff's office, and Mike, the family has hired its own pathologist, and they have a very different theory, even though police today closed the case.
They did close the case, Jovita, and the family says their pathologist has different theories about some of the injuries on Horsford's body. The family says their fight for answers is not over.
This exclusive video a source gave us shows Tamla Horsford in the last hours of her life last November at an adult sleepover birthday party at this Forsyth County home. The next morning,
I'm guessing maybe she fell off the balcony.
Partygoers found her dead. The homeowner called 911.
We had people over last night. We were drinking. Most of us went to bed. One of them stayed on the balcony. She was drinking, and we just went outside, and she's laying face down in the backyard.
The state of Georgia medical examiner has ruled the death accidental and consistent with a fall.
Wednesday, Forsyth County Sheriff's Major Joe Perkins announced a GBI-led autopsy found no signs of foul play.
No evidence or injury patterns indicative of an assault.
Horsford's father spoke to Atlanta DJ Ryan Cameron's radio show after the sheriff's announcement.
Her injuries are not consistent with what they're saying. This is so fishy. I just don't want it to get out of hand.
Her father says a pathologist they hired found injuries on Tamla's body they believe happened after she was already dead. They believe someone may have tossed her body off of the deck.
Her wrist was cut. The bone was broken. Where they say the body was, there was no blood pool. That means she was already dead.
So she wasn't intoxicated to the point of falling off of a deck.
We spoke by phone Thursday to Horsford's best friend, Michelle Graves.
And still, if she was that drunk, and they say that they left her out on the balcony alone, why would you leave somebody that is so intoxicated? Why would you have left her alone? Did you not check on her? Like, how did she get over onto the deck? Like, how did she get over a 4-foot railing on a deck?
Well, within the last 2 hours, we got a new statement from the homeowner who hosted that party through her attorney that says, quote, in part, our clients are completely innocent of any wrongdoing. They have not had a chance to grieve the death of Mrs. Horsford either. Our clients were friends with Mrs. Horsford, too. This accident is heartbreaking that a mother of five lost her life too early and that her children have to grow up without a mother. Reporting live in Forsyth County, Mike Buchanek, Channel 2 Action News.
And Mike, we know that this happened back in November. Many people are asking, what about her husband? Is there nothing that he wants to come forward to say about his wife or what happened that night?
Well, I can tell you this, Jovita. My understanding is that he has had to go to work every day. He's supporting five children at home. We went to the house a couple of times. I've met with her father and her aunt. They tell me that they're working with an attorney down in Florida. We know that the attorney has reached out to the sheriff to have a meeting to go over that case file, and they really don't want to make any public statements if they can until they've had a chance to go through the documents that were released.
Now, Tamla, who was the only black person at the sleepover with all of these white women and a couple of men, and everyone was drinking, and somehow this black woman turns up dead. Now, I don't know how somebody that drunk could make it to the balcony all alone, somehow get over a 4-foot railing, and then fall to her death because she was drunk. And to me, when they called 911, they seemed real calm for their friend to be laying in their backyard dead. And of course, the guy on the 911 call had already got in trouble going in people's files. And the whole story just doesn't add up. But the police, getting on call right away, said it was an accident and said the case was closed. Now, this mother of five is dead and nobody knows anything except for it was an accident. Because no matter what, when we come up dead, it is somehow our fault. Then you got people like Ed Buck and black people keep turning up dead at his house.
Something, there's going to be a third body.
Tough talk today from the mother of a man who overdosed and died inside the West Hollywood apartment of a prominent Democratic Party donor, Ed Buck. The man was one of two men to die there. NBC4's I-Team has been following developments in these cases, and our investigative reporter, Eric Leonard, tonight has more on new legal action and a personal demand from a mother who wants criminal charges. Eric?
Well, Chuck, activists have visited the office of L.A. County District Attorney Jackie Lacey, urging her to file criminal charges for the deaths of Jamel Moore in 2017 and Timothy Dean earlier this year. Both men died inside the West Hollywood apartment of Ed Buck, who has not been accused, arrested, or charged with a crime. Moore's mother made a personal appeal for action in criminal court. And for the first time you'll see here, she's taking her own legal action in civil court.
Arrest Ed Buck!
Activists from several community groups, including Color of Change and Black Lives Matter, were turned away at the front doors of the Hall of Justice while trying to deliver more than 30,000 petition signatures demanding criminal charges. Leading the group, Letitia Nixon, Jamel Moore's mother, who flew in from Texas to address the crowd and deliver the signatures. She says she's tired of waiting.
What is it going to take? What is it going to take for DA Jackie Lacey to prosecute him?
Nixon has told NBC4 she's also decided to file a wrongful death lawsuit, not only against Ed Buck, but also against the DA's office and the case prosecutor.
Many cannot bring my son back. Nothing can bring him back. I just want Ed Buck and whoever is protecting him to know that we mean business.
Her 26-year-old son, Jamel, died of a methamphetamine overdose July 27, 2017. The death was initially ruled accidental, but after Nixon and activists demanded a closer look, the sheriff's department said it would re-examine the case, though no charges were filed.
I just think they don't care.
Her lawsuit accuses Buck of wrongful death, sexual battery, assault, hate violence, and other violations. It says Mr. Buck injected Mr. Moore with a lethal dose of crystal methamphetamine.
My son's life mattered.
Nixon's attorneys say Lacey is also liable for failing to take action, and they say that's because of Jamel Moore's character.
It has a lot to do with Jamel and Timothy and the fact that they were black.
Civil lawsuit doesn't only get some level of accountability from Ed Buck and from the district attorney's office, the county, in the language that they understand, which is money, but it also enables us to expose what Ed Buck is doing.
Nixon says Lacey owes it to the public to take action.
She represents everybody, not just black people, everybody. She represents what's right.
Now, Buck has repeatedly denied that he had a hand in these deaths, saying both Moore and Dean used drugs on their own and were willing participants in the encounters in his apartment.
Now, this is the second time somebody has died at his house. They claim from ODing on drugs, and yet he still haven't been arrested, charged, no kind of punishment. Not even for the drugs that somebody could OD in his house. And they're saying he's not responsible for these black people that keep turning up dead in his house. And the LGBTQ community is quiet. They don't have anything to say about this. They're more concerned with a joke that black comedians might tell than black people coming up dead. Because at the end of the day, we are all we got. We can't stop until we start punishing people for harming us. That's the only way it's going to stop. We don't have a choice but to create our own justice system and to enforce it ourselves. But until we do, we have to learn how to protect ourselves. For some reason, everybody seems to think protecting yourself and standing ground applies to everybody but us. But we have to stop taking these L's. We've had so many casualties, we can't keep taking more. At the end of the day, however hard it might be, we're going to have to do what we have to do to get what we have to get.
2 years before the fire, Little Rock and Governor Orville Faubus gained national attention in 1957 during the desegregation crisis at Central High School. Faubus again made headlines when he shut down Little Rock High Schools for the 1958-1959 school year, often referred to as the lost year. Lawrence believes the events that followed added fuel to the Wrightsville school's flames.
This Holocaust and this murder is a similar event that was designed to trigger an action by the African American community to say, oh no, we're not gonna try to integrate schools anymore. We'll go ahead and be separate but equal, but we're gonna stop this desegregation activity.
Prior to the fire, Governor Faubus had toured the Wrightsville school and saw firsthand the conditions in which the boys lived, but made no recommendations for change. However, newspaper articles reported Faubus appeared disturbed by the deaths of the 21 boys, calling the fire inexcusable. He immediately called for a hearing to determine who may have been responsible for the deaths of the children.
The very morning that these boys were killed, they're dismantling this whole scene with hoses, rakes, and shovels. They're tearing it apart like they're trying to cover up something.
The school staff and superintendent all gave their accounts of what happened that night of the fire, noting that the boys had been locked in and left unsupervised for the night. Conversely, a Pulaski County grand jury found that numerous individuals and agencies were responsible, but ultimately, they returned no criminal charges.
Unfortunately, it's just like blaming everybody and nobody.
In the meantime, in an ironic twist, the land in which the school stood is now the Arkansas Department of Correction Facility, Wrightsville Unit, where you won't find a plaque to indicate the boys ever lived or died there.
That the bodies are in here in this open space where there's no markers.
The same omission exists at their supposed mass grave, which can be found at the Haven of Rest Cemetery in Little Rock.
The bodies was brought out here and a mass grave was dug, just a series of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 through 14, and the bodies were interred there.
According to cemetery records, hours after the fire, what little remained of the boys who died was taken to a local funeral home. According to Stephanie Webb, several sources say the boys' body parts were brought over wrapped in newspaper.
Most of the bodies were brought to Dubison Funeral Home, which of course now no longer exists. And as far as how they were received, I mean, there's a lot of questionable stuff.
The parents of the boys could come in and pick out body parts a la carte and claim that they were their children.
Seven of the 21 boys were buried privately by their families. The other 14 are supposedly buried in a mass grave. Their brief funeral and burial paid for by the state of Arkansas.
After the ceremony was over, the family members were ushered away from the cemetery and not allowed to view the interment into the burial plot. So they never saw coffins go into the ground.
And as for a grave marker,
because the records indicate and marker, it had and marker on the records. Bronze memorial for the 14 boys who were buried. That's what it says.
So where is it?
I have no idea.
Blackface.
Good morning, sir.
Hello, monkey.
Two San Diego-based Marines now under investigation after posting a video that appears to show the two wearing blackface. 10 News reporter Rachel Bianco live at MCAS Miramar. And Rachel, some people are calling for the Marines to be kicked out of the military.
Yeah, Brian, many calling this conduct unbecoming of a Marine. Now, officials here at MCAS won't say if the two are stationed here at Miramar, but they confirm they are treating the matter seriously and an investigation is underway.
Blackface.
Good morning, sir.
Two Marines appearing in uniform with their faces blackened. One of them then puts on his cap and salutes. According to KPBS, Zach Highfield posted the video on Snapchat. His Instagram page shows him in his Marine uniform.
My reaction is kind of like, you know, here we go again.
Bishop Cornelius Bowser is a pastor at Charity Apostolic Church.
I was kind of like surprised that, you know, even guys in the military would do this in their uniforms. Now, that's a shame right there, you know, to do that that way, to promote this type of racism and bigotry.
People on Twitter demanding the Marines get kicked out of the military. Bowser agrees.
We pay our tax dollars for them to protect and serve and serving our country. And this is not it right here. That kind of display, that kind of character should not be allowed.
A spokesman with the 3rd Marine Aircraft Wing issued a statement that reads in part, 3rd MAW takes all allegations of discriminatory behavior very seriously as they stand in stark contrast of our core values of honor, courage, and commitment.
One of the concerns is like how we know that these guys, if he have to catch a black person's back, will he catch his back, you know, and how deep does this go?
Highfield told a KPBS reporter the blackface is made of a charcoal mask used to clean pores. He said they didn't mean to offend anyone.
I believe they knew exactly what they were doing. I don't know if they were just looking for attention or they just thought they would get away with it, or maybe they wanted to be kicked out of the military. I don't know what their motive is behind doing this.
We tried calling the number for Highfield that was on his Instagram page. The voicemail was full and he did not respond to my text.
This morning, the Virginia governor's mansion facing a new allegation of racial insensitivity.
This time, it's First Lady Pam Northam who's under fire over an incident that allegedly took place during a tour of the executive mansion's old slave quarters. According to a letter obtained by the Richmond Times-Dispatch, Leah Walker, a Virginia State employee, says Mrs. Northam upset her eighth-grade daughter. The young girl also detailing the episode in a separate letter, saying the First Lady handed cotton to her and another African-American child while asking them to, quote, imagine being an enslaved person. Walker's daughter describing it as beyond inappropriate, especially considering recent events with the governor. The letters were first reported by the Washington Post. Mrs. Northam telling NBC News, I have provided the same educational tour to Executive Mansion visitors over the last few months and used a variety of artifacts and agricultural crops with the intention of illustrating a painful period of Virginia history. I regret that I have upset anyone. Walker telling NBC News, she's extremely disappointed in official responses that are as tone-deaf and insensitive as the initial bad act. All this is Pam Northam's husband, Governor Ralph Northam, continues to ignore calls for his resignation over that racist photo on his med school yearbook page. The governor did admit that he once darkened his skin to dress up like Michael Jackson for a dance contest. It was the First Lady who stopped him from showing off his skills during a freewheeling press conference.
Are you still able to move along?
Inappropriate circumstances.
My wife says inappropriate circumstances.
It's just the latest controversy confronting Virginia's top elected leaders. The state's attorney general, Mark Herring, trying to bounce back from his own blackface scandal.
Delegate discipline tonight. Harford County Delegate Marianne Lasanti is refusing to resign after the House unanimously voted to censure her for using a racial slur. WJZ is live. Kelsey Kushner has reaction from Delegate Lasanti and what this means moving forward. Kelsey?
That's right. Well, Lasanti said tonight she's not going to resign from her seat, but says instead she's going to use this time to focus on rebuilding her relationship with the community. It was a unanimous vote Thursday from the Maryland House of Delegates. Harford County Delegate Marianne Lasanti censured after she admitted to calling Prince George's County an N-word district at an Annapolis cigar bar. Shortly after the decision, the Democrats spoke out saying she's not going to resign.
I have full voting powers here on the floor. And if I leave, there will not be a replacement during this legislative session. So that will deprive the people of Harford County a vote on the budget and very important issues that face our county.
Because of the censure, Lasanti can no longer hold a position on a committee, but can vote on the House floor because she's an elected official. Delegates called it a sad day, censuring one of their own, but felt it had to be done.
With this vote, we are saying as a body that racial slurs and racially charged language cannot and will not be tolerated by this House.
And before Thursday's votes, calls for Lasanti to resign were growing across the state, like from the governor and even from fellow Democrats.
When you come to work and you're paid by the people of the state of Maryland and you utter those words at work, you ought to lose your job.
Lasanti first denied ever using the word, saying she didn't remember, then later issued an apology in a statement. Thursday night, Lasanti said she doesn't believe she used the word, but is trusting other people and is accepting responsibility for it. She also said the racial slur is not in her vocabulary.
I too denounce this word. It is not in my vocabulary and does not represent my belief system, my life's work, or my heart.
Now, Lasanti has since stepped down from her leadership roles, and she agreed to participate in sensitivity training. She says starting tomorrow, she plans on meeting with some of the community members to start rebuilding that relationship.
Tonight, recent incidents of police officers turning off their body cams have state lawmakers taking action. Good evening, I'm Richard Ransom.
And I'm Katina Rankin. Some lawmakers want officers to be charged with felonies if they turn off their body cams with the intent to obstruct justice. But the head of the police union says that's going way too far. Local 24 News reporter Rebecca Butcher has tonight's top story, and she joins us live in studio. Rebecca, break this down for us.
Yeah, well, according to Tennessee Representative G.A. Hardaway, the goal is to make the law simpler for both citizens and also officers. But the Memphis Police Association calls this bill counterproductive.
We've had some incidents, some in Memphis,
some in other parts of the nation, where body cams were turned off intentionally and evidence was lost, evidence was tampered with.
Representative G.A. Hardaway is talking about a proposed bill that would make it a felony offense for an officer to turn off or disable a recording device with the intent to obstruct justice. This comes after two Memphis police officers were suspended last week for turning off their body cams after the chase and shooting of Martavius Banks back in September.
We feel that any disciplinary action that may arise from violation of that policy is warranted. Now, we don't feel that the behavior should be criminalized. We certainly don't feel that it should rise to the level of being a felony.
Sergeant Matt Cunningham with the Memphis Police Association says that Memphis officers are already worrying about everything going on with the scene, and dealing with a possible criminal prosecution is just too much.
To add one more stressor to officers, we've had a lot of members say that this would be the straw that breaks the camel's back and they would find another line of work.
Meanwhile, Hardaway insists the bill is doing the opposite and making officers' jobs more stress-free.
There's already the ability to prosecute for tampering with evidence, and that's a Class C felony.
And the bill would offer the option for a lower Class E felony. And Hardaway also says that he looks forward to speaking to the Memphis Police Association and urges officers to read the bill for themselves. If the bill does pass, it will take effect July 1st.
Meanwhile, across America, statues are being toppled. Streets and schools have been renamed. We're in the middle of a revolution, remember, all for the sake of purging the memory of long ago racism. But in New York, they have a very different plan. They're now honoring a genocidal dictator. Amazing. The city council, led by Jumaane Williams, who's a frequent guest on this show, if you watch, you'll know exactly who he is, running for lieutenant governor of New York right now, just voted to rename a street after the Haitian dictator Jean-Jacques Dessalines. In the early 1800s, Dessalines ordered the genocide of all white people on the island. That included men, women, and children. And he did it. It's what he is best known for. New York City apparently finds that impressive, so impressive, they're going to name a street after him. Seth Barron is associate editor of City Journal. He joins us tonight. Seth, thanks a lot for coming on. Did I ever state that?
No, I think you were right. I mean, you were right. Welcome to Year Zero.
What is this about? Exactly.
Well, you know, I think it would make perfect sense to have a statue or a street named after Jean-Jacques Dessalines in Port-au-Prince, the Haitian capital.
Right.
I don't understand why we're doing it in New York City. I mean, there are a number of Haitians here in Brooklyn, near there. But, this is advocated by the same people, Jumaane Williams and others, who want to tear down the Statue of Columbus at Columbus Circle, who want to rename, Stuyvesant High School because Stuyvesant owned slaves. So it's a very extreme kind of measure. I mean, if you recall, a year ago, Jumaane Williams was very much in favor of the Puerto Rican Day Parade honoring Oscar Lopez Rivera. I know you had him on then. Oscar Lopez Rivera was a terrorist who bombed a major historic landmark downtown and killed several people, including a cop. But this is who, there he is. This is who the city is now apparently honoring and favoring.
There are a couple of interesting things about this, but the first is that multiculturalism isn't real. So we were told that multiculturalism is when lots of cultures kind of coexist happily and all that. This is really destroying one culture and replacing it with a foreign culture. I mean, we're taking your monuments down and putting ours up. I mean, that's kind of what's going on.
Well, I talked to one member of the city council, a Republican, who voted for it, for this street renaming, and he sort of indicated that this was like insurance or a SOP. This way, this will protect Columbus. Like, if we give them this street for after Dessalines, then they won't come after Columbus. And I said, that's like the strategy of feeding your friends to the crocodiles in hopes that they'll eat you last. I think that they'll have Dessalines and take Columbus eventually, when they're ready.
But Columbus discovered America, and this is America, so maybe there's a reason we celebrate Columbus. Dessalines, whatever, I'm sure he had good points in addition to being a genocidal nutcase.
Sure.
No one is monochromatic, but, like, what does that have to do with America?
Well,
I mean,
history,
nothing, right?
History's complicated, and everybody has their mixed story. According to Jumaane Williams, Columbus, Jefferson, Washington, it's all arbitrary why they're honored and Dessalines or Mugabe, yeah. I guess, aren't.
That's next, Mugabe.
No, why are you calling the cops right now? Because I told you I wasn't leaving the park because my dog was humping your dog. Right, I'm not verbally assaulting you. I told you I'm not leaving.
The Attleboro dog park.
That's inappropriate for the dog park.
No, it's not.
I know
it's not. Dogs humping each other and she's calling the cops because my dog humped her dog. I've seen every single dog hump another dog here. And she tells me to leave and now she's calling the cops. Like, are you serious?
Yeah, they will. They'll.
Yo, I can't wait. Yo, this is crazy. Because this, you heard of Barbecue Becky? Because this is the newest one. Right here.
989.
Let me get her plate. Let's see. So everybody know who this woman is. We can look this woman up.
You can.
3ZN996.
Honestly. I'm just trying.
You're not trying to help me.
I'm trying to tell you.
No, you're not trying to help me. I know the rules.
I'm
obeying the rules. What are you talking about? I'm right here.
You can't allow your dog aggressively on top of another
dog. The dogs hump each other every day. And I took him off the. I took him off. I know it's my opinion. But you don't call the cops over it. That's all I'm saying.
That's not.
You just don't call the cops over it.
All right, and we back on the forecast. Now, from day one, America's goal has always been to criminalize us. They've always used the argument that we are the savages to justify what they were doing so they could sleep at night. That's why they make everything we do a crime, even though they turn around and do the same thing and then profit off of it. In reality, it's just an excuse to say you got what you deserved, a way to vindicate themselves in their own mind. But as long as we let outsiders keep coming in, doing whatever they want without consequence, it's gonna keep happening. But until we fully adapt a mindset of freedom and liberty or nothing, other groups are gonna continue to come in and disrespect and harm us, and then turn around to justify it by saying we deserve it. In 1800, there was a brother named Gabriel Prosser, who led what is known as Gabriel's Rebellion. Now, the year before, in 1799, Gabriel and two other slaves ended up stealing a pig from a white person who lived around the plantation. And out of hunger and desperation, a lot of black people would steal pigs so they could eat and feed their families. Which of course they used as propaganda to say that we are all thieves, and we still see the effects of it today. But when the white guy came out to confront Gabriel about the pig, they ended up getting into a fight. And Gabriel Prosser ended up biting the white dude's ear off. Now on top of charging him with stealing the pig, they charged him with harming a white man, which was a felony punishable by death. The only reason they didn't put him to death then was because of a loophole in the law that said if he could quote one Bible verse, then they won't execute him. And even though they didn't execute him, they still whipped him and branded him and put him in jail. Then after he got out, he decided to organize all the slaves in Richmond to kill all the slave owners and racist white people in the city. And he had around 1,000 people organized. But on the night it was supposed to take place, it started raining. And a lot of people didn't even show up. And it was raining so hard, the people who showed up anyway still couldn't make it to the city. So they decided to wait until the next night. But before the next night came, a couple of slaves on two different plantations ended up telling their slave masters about the plan. And they ended up telling the governor, James Monroe. And he sent out a militia to arrest anybody who even looked like they were going to be involved. They did eventually catch Gabriel Prosser. But during the trial, he refused to speak or even testify at all. He refused to give him an explanation. Another one of the rebels said, "I have nothing more to say in my defense than George Washington would have had to say to the British if they caught him." And to be honest, I couldn't say George Washington would have went out with the same kind of honor as they did. Because Gabriel Prosser and the soldiers with him went out like the warriors they were. They didn't beg for forgiveness. Gabriel Prosser had the mindset of freedom so much, he created a flag that said death or liberty, and his only request was to be executed with the people who fought with him. Now, they did wait to execute him the same day. Just to show him disrespect one last time, they still took him to be hung by himself. But this brother understood the situation in 1800, and he understood the mindset you have to have. His only problem was somebody told on him right before he took action. When people harm you, there has to be consequences, or it's going to keep happening. And right now, people still have immunity for harming us.
You have cases like what happened to the brother Larry Jackson Jr. in Austin, Texas. This brother, who was unarmed, was shot in the back of the head by Detective Charles Kleinert. Now let's see what justifies this cop shooting his brother in the back of the head while he was running away.
Grand jury testimony in Texas is usually kept a secret.
But for the first time, we're hearing how a former Austin police officer explained his actions before he shot and killed a man running from the scene of a bank robbery back in 2013. In May, Charles Kleinert pleaded not guilty after a grand jury indicted him. Also this spring, his attorney successfully moved the case to federal court. They argue Kleinert was acting as part of an FBI task force the day he shot Larry Jackson Jr. KXAN investigator Robert Maxwell has been poring over the now public testimony.
And we can tell you at several points in his testimony, the transcript shows Charles Kleinert crying as he recounts the seconds leading up to Larry Jackson Jr.'s death 2 summers ago.
The day of the robbery, surveillance video showed then-officer Charles Kleinert emerge from the bank to speak to Larry Jackson Jr. before a chase and struggle that would end Jackson's life. The grand jury testimony now shows us what Kleinert allegedly said to Jackson that day. Bank staff earlier told Kleinert Jackson was pretending to be another customer to access his account. He said, "The customer is my brother and he's been in a car wreck and I need some money." When Kleinert challenged Jackson to call the brother, he says Jackson took off running. What no one saw was when Kleinert caught up with Jackson under a bridge by Shoal Creek. The veteran detective told the grand jury he had one hand on Jackson's shirt and had hit him at least once with the other hand that held his gun. The weapon fired once as Kleinert fell during a struggle. A bullet struck Jackson in the neck, killing him. He said, "I can see his eyes." Kleinert was crying as he recounted this. "And I already know what's happened. I already know, but I'm thinking, please don't let that have happened." Typically, grand jury hearings are kept secret. It's to avoid tainting a future jury who would hear an eventual criminal trial. But Texas law allows exceptions in this case to help the federal judge hearing Kleinert's case to rule on a motion to dismiss it. An attorney not connected with the case says it's in the state code.
It's rare, but it can happen on a good cause. And it sounds like in this situation, under the Code of Criminal Procedure, the prosecution can release that, again, upon a judge's order or for good cause to assist in the investigation or the prosecution of an individual.
Kleinert's gun discharged once, striking Jackson in the back of the head, killing the unarmed man. The detective claims his gun accidentally went off. It's been a back and forth debate over the charges against Kleinert and where the case against him should be tried. In May 2014, a Travis County grand jury indicted the former detective on manslaughter charges. A federal judge later dismissed that indictment, saying Kleinert was immune to state prosecution because he was part of that federal task force. The state is appealing that action with the hope Kleinert will still be subject to federal prosecution.
That's also the hope for Jackson's parents. Today's oral hearing will decide the following question: should the district judge's order that Kleinert has immunity be reversed or upheld? I spoke with the family's attorney this afternoon, who says the family is still fighting for justice. What would the family want for this ruling to happen?
Well, of course, we want the ruling reversed. We believe that the judge's ruling was flawed on a number of levels, and we believe that Charles Kleinert should be prosecuted just like any other regular citizen would have been in this situation. It is very unfortunate, and it's candidly a disgrace that he was let off for what we believe was a murder of Larry Jackson due to some goofy legal technicality.
Now, this brother, Larry Jackson, went to the bank, but it just so happened to be closed because somebody tried to rob it earlier that day. And the cop, Detective Charles Kleinert, came out to talk to him after he saw him standing outside. Now, I don't know why he would go to a bank that's full of cops to try to commit a crime, but the cop said he gave the name of somebody else trying to get access to their account, trying to say he was about to commit fraud. And the cop said when he asked him to call the person, he took off running. So then this cop, Charles Kleinhart, trying to be John McClane or somebody, took somebody's car with them still in it. He jumped in the passenger side and just told him to drive. He didn't even identify himself. Just some random guy jumps in your car and tell you to drive just to go chase this brother down. And on top of that, I'm pretty sure cops are not supposed to put people in danger like that. So then he spotted him, and when he caught up, he said he tried to grab him with one hand and then with the gun in his other hand started hitting him. Then the cop said as he tried to hit him again, this brother turned around and knocked him down. And the cop said during the scuffle, the gun accidentally went off. He said his hand wasn't even on the trigger, it was on the slide. And he really trying to say this brother pulled the trigger himself without just coming out and saying that. But the problem is, if he turned around and the gun went off during the scuffle, How did he end up shot in the back of the head? And so much evidence that says he was running away. Now, 3 months after the shooting, this cop, Charles Kleiner, ended up retiring from the force, most likely so he can still get all of his benefits. And even though the cops and the police unions were caping for him, a grand jury still indicted him with manslaughter.
A former APD detective charged with manslaughter took the stand in a hearing that could grant him immunity from prosecution. Charles Kleinert is charged with shooting and killing Larry Jackson Jr. in July of 2013.
But his role in a federal task force has already caused the case to be moved to a federal court and may lead it to getting thrown out altogether. Chris Sadeghi is live at the courthouse downtown where Kleinert told and even acted out his version of what happened today. Chris?
Well, Shannon, at one point in the courtroom, Kleinert had a replica gun in his hand and was acting with his attorney, reenacting the exact movements that led to the gun going off and killing Larry Jackson. They also had a wooden slope that they'd created in the courtroom to simulate the incline that Kleinert says the two men were on. He hopes all of this presentation will help lead to the charge against him being dropped. After chasing down Larry Jackson, Charles Kleinert said he was going to arrest him. He told the court Wednesday he thought Jackson was a suspect for bank fraud, and because he had not searched him for weapons, procedure calls for an officer to pull their gun for that type of arrest. But Jackson tried to run, according to Kleinert, with his gun in hand. He said he swung twice at Jackson's lower back to force him to the ground, but Jackson did not respond. Kleinert's voice cracked at times on the stand when talking about the gunshot he said was never meant to be fired. As he went for a third strike to the back, he said Jackson spun around and knocked him down. As he fell, he heard his gun discharge and wondered why, since his finger was on the slide. He said both of them fell face down beside each other, and when he looked over at Jackson's face, blood was coming out of his mouth and his eyes were fixed. And that's when Kleinert said he knew exactly what happened. On the stand, Kleinert said he was crushed and devastated by Jackson's death, but also said he was doing what he believed were the actions necessary to stop crime that day. And this hearing is expected to go on Thursday and Friday, and then Judge Lee Yackel will have a decision to make. We're hearing tomorrow that Texas Rangers could take the stand to give their investigation and what it found about this shooting.
Now, a judge ended up sending this case to federal court because he was acting as a federal officer at the time. And since he was acting as a federal officer, he deserves special immunity for killing this unarmed black man by shooting him in the back of the head. And of course, the judge, Lee Yackel, ended up dismissing the case against him, saying this cop taking a person's car with them in it to go chase down the suspect for a crime they might be about to commit and end up shooting him in the back of the head was reasonable and necessary. The judge said he was acting within his federal duty, so he dismissed the case.
Travis County's taking former APD Detective Charles Kleinert's case to the Supreme Court after he was charged with manslaughter. That case was dismissed in 2015. Jacqueline Sarkeesian is live at the federal courthouse with the latest. Jacqueline.
Well, Dave, the Travis County Commissioner's Court just approved a contract with an Austin attorney to help bring criminal charges against Kleinert. Now, the former APD detective was indicted for killing Larry Jackson Jr. in 2013. The officer was investigating a bank robbery when authorities say he shot Jackson in the back. The case was dismissed 2 years ago when the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals ruled that Kleinert was immune because he was acting as a federal officer. Since then, District Attorney Margaret Moore vowed to take the case to the Supreme Court if necessary. And yesterday, the Travis County Commissioner's Court approved a contract to hire former Texas Supreme Court Chief Justice Wallace Jefferson and his law firm. They will help the DA's office present this case before the justices.
We're happy to go to the Supreme Court. We will go there and defend the actions of the officer. It's not going to change the law. It's not going to change what happened in New Orleans at the Fifth Circuit. It's not going to change what happened here.
Moore released a statement on the case that says, quote, the district attorney's office remains firmly committed to seeking the fair administration of justice, as well as clarity regarding the immunity granted by the court in this matter. She goes on to say her team of highly skilled attorneys are working on a petition that will be filed with the high court. Moore's statement also says that Jefferson's firm is internationally known. It goes on to say that the attorney himself has won two cases before the Supreme Court.
Now, even though this cop, Charles Kleinert, is one of the few cops ever indicted, The judge essentially overruled a grand jury and a DA who said it's alarming that an Austin cop can just be assigned a federal task and get immunity for killing an unarmed black person. This cop was even found guilty and liable during a civil trial. Because they found the cop was in the wrong, they ended up paying his parents $600,000 and his children over $1.2 million, which was the biggest payout in state history. But when it comes to the criminal trial and actually punishing them, nothing. Despite whatever a grand jury has to say, a judge can just give a cop immunity. And historically, they have gotten immunity for killing us while it's punishable by death to even harm them. At the end of the day, we can see we are the only ones that are going to look out for us and protect us. And we are all we got. We don't have any choice but to get on code and do what we have to do. And the illusion of inclusion is starting to fade away. And more of us are starting to see what it is. And it is causing fear in a lot of people. Because when we realize what everybody else already knows, then things will change.
Give me your ID, give me your information.
So I'm getting off work, right? You see, I work at Subway. And I'm coming to CVS. I'm walking across the street. And this guy gonna pull me over, and I'm walking. I'm not even fucking driving. What the fuck going on, man?
It's 24 right now.
Pleasant Grove, Alabama, man. 35127. What's the word, dude? You stopped and told me.
Hey, I'm gonna give you just a little
bit. You stopped and told me.
I'm gonna give you just a little bit before you go to jail.
Don't walk like that. And I said, okay.
No, I said, get on across the road. You're about to come to a standstill.
And when you told me that, I was already at
then,
the gas station.
When I get right here, you walk back out in the edge of the road.
That's a
here.
Fucking sidewalk. Well, I'm supposed to walk on the grass. If it ain't no fucking sidewalk in fucking Alabama, what am I supposed to do about that? Why you stop me? Tell me why you stop me. Tell me why you stop me.
I can come out and tell you anytime I want to.
You can do whatever the fuck you want to do.
This ain't a traffic stop.
I know, because I ain't fucking driving. I'm walking. I just got off work. I work at Subway. I just got done making fucking 18,000 Subway sandwiches.
It doesn't matter.
You're not telling me why you fucking stopping me.
I don't care. At this point, I'll tell you why you're going to jail.
Wow.
Right now, I need you to put your hands against this car. I'm going to check you for any weapons.
Wow.
Put your hands against the car right now.
By the Newman Church parking lot?
No.
Were you arguing with someone tonight?
Nope.
So where are you coming from, you said?
Work.
And you don't know where work is?
I know where work is, but I just started.
You chop wood, but where do you work?
I work on Irk Street.
On 4th Street?
Oak
Street.
And 10th.
Okay, so you didn't see any fights, any arguing?
Nope. I just got off and I walked home.
You've been by yourself all this time?
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Am I being detained?
Yes, you are. Correct.
For what probable cause?
Not arrested or anything. We're just trying to figure some stuff out right now.
Okay.
We just had a description that matched your description.
It matched my description.
Yeah.
And what was that? A black guy?
Male black wearing dark clothes.
Wearing dark clothes?
Do you have an idea of your weapon?
No.
No, I have no idea.
What's your name?
Calvin.
Calvin what?
Calvin. I just go by Calvin.
What's your last name?
Calvin.
Do you have an ID, any type of identification on you?
Am I being...
You are being detained. So you
am I being accused of a crime?
How you doing?
How you doing?
I'm good. Were you down at the church here at some sort of argument?
The third time, no.
Well, I wasn't here for the first or the second time, so first time for you.
Well, I'm letting you know that's the third time I was asked that.
Okay. All right. Do you have your ID on you?
Nope.
No ID?
Just Calvin.
Am I being...
Yes, you are detained.
Yes, you're
not free to leave.
But am I being... Am I being...
We were just told that someone was walking down this direction, and you're the only person who's walking down this direction, who just witnessed an argument of some type. So we're just investigating what's going on.
Okay. I'll let you guys know that I just came from work.
Yes, but you didn't know. It took you about 20 minutes to name where you were.
Think where you were working at.
15. Well, I just said I just came from work.
We just want to know if you were involved in an argument in that church parking lot, because somebody called in that there were two people. Don't show me my eyes.
Okay, I need to see your badge and your
name. Same six. Just turn the light off.
Okay, I'm going to just stand back some then. Because I just said I just came from work.
Yeah. Were you in the church parking lot in an argument with somebody?
No.
No? Not at all.
Not at all.
All right. Well, I'm going to see if the witness that called that in is still around.
Okay.
If they are, I'll have them come up here.
I believe I'm still have my glasses, my time card.
Can't see what it says. Identification badge.
Time card.
From work, you mean?
Yes.
You weren't in a silver Prius with anybody else down in that church parking lot.
If I was in the silver Prius, why would I be walking out?
Maybe you got in an argument with them and got out of the car. I don't know. I wasn't there. That's.
I wasn't there either. So
when you show up, we gotta ask questions.
I wasn't there either. So I don't know. I don't know what's going on.
If I knew the answers, I wouldn't have to ask all the questions. If I knew you weren't involved, I wouldn't have to ask you if you were involved, right?
Well, I just said I wasn't involved.
Huh?
I just said I wasn't involved. I just came from work.
I know, but I don't know that, so I gotta ask you this stuff.
That's I just answered the questions that you asked me.
Believe it or not, people lie to us sometimes.
Well,
they might shock you.
You guys lie too. So
we do. Oh yeah. So let me figure out what's going on.
Okay.
If we don't need you anymore, we'll get you on your way.
I'm kind of late for dinner, so.
We're gonna have the initial witness come and tell us if he was the one for us.
Perfect. Did they say he had a blue hat with?
They just said he was walking northbound on the sidewalk on Normal Road.
With dark clothes.
And that's you. You're the only one walking northbound on Normal
Road. The only description they can give. It was a black male with dark clothes, no hat, no book bag on. I mean, any type of specifics?
I don't know the specifics.
Not specifically saying that he had a book bag on or...
No, they didn't like the name, the logo gray. Of your hat. They didn't know the kind of shoes you had, nothing.
Well, then who is they actually looking for then?
Now, imagine you're watching our late night news when you hear your back door rattling and then you see a red laser pointed on your chest.
One Portsmouth man says it happened to him. And in a neighborhood where weapons are everywhere, he didn't hesitate to grab his own gun. 10 Your Side's Andy Fox shows us it was a decision with lingering repercussions. What are we talking about here, Andy?
Tom and Nicole, decision to shoot. Brandon Watson is absolutely sure the way he reacted to red laser sights on his chest justified what he did. The question is, would the legal system agree? And who was in his backyard anyway?
January 3rd, 2013, a single shot through a window. Brandon Watson claims he was protecting his family when his wife heard noises in the backyard.
She said, oh my gosh, somebody's in our backyard.
Noises getting closer.
She heard.
So they were coming in the back door.
Yeah. We ran upstairs. Very quickly. She saw guys in all black from right here.
Watson says he couldn't immediately find his cell phone to call 911.
So I run downstairs with my firearm and I post right here. I announce myself. I said, who is that? Who is that? I have a gun. And as soon as I said that, a couple red laser beams was on my chest.
A gun laser sight aiming where a shot would hit.
So I looked at the red laser beams on my chest and I fired a warning shot.
He ran to get help from a state police neighbor across the street.
I said, whoa. I said, whoa. They said, who shot this shot? I said, I did. I have a gun in my hand. They said, put the gun down.
This is Watson's handgun. He immediately dropped and then got stunning news.
We just got news that you shot at an officer. I said, officer? I said, nobody came to my door. What you mean, officer? Nobody, you know, I didn't know there was no officers.
The dark figures in the backyard were Portsmouth police officers who did not announce themselves.
As far as the officer's response, I support their response 100%.
Portsmouth Police Chief Ed Hargis claims his men never heard Watson.
Anytime a police officer hears that there's a firearm involved, they start giving verbal commands. They start yelling police.
It came out in court police were in the wrong backyard. They were supposed to be in Patricia Brooks' yard, who lives next door to Watson. She had called 911 because she heard unrelated noises downstairs. Portsmouth Commonwealth's attorney Earl Mobley explains how police ended up in the wrong backyard.
When they go around to the back, is it two houses down? Is it three? Is it four?
But when they go around to the back, they see one of the gates open, which raises their suspicion about that must be the house.
Mobley admits Watson did not know police were in his backyard, but prosecutes him anyway for misdemeanor reckless handling of a firearm.
You can't just fire indiscriminately through the window.
A judge agrees, and Brandon's found guilty and appeals. A second judge declares a mistrial. Then Brandon chooses to have a jury trial.
This can't be doing your job when you come in my backyard, try to open my door, open my window, then flash red laser beams on my chest because you thought I was the burglar. And I thought you was the burglar.
The seven-person jury buys that and finds Brandon Watson not guilty after only 47 minutes deliberating. Wavy TV employee and juror Danny Barnes.
It wasn't reckless.
The jurors and I disagree with that point.
The jury thought Watson showed restraint, only firing one shot.
There was agreement that if there had been more than one bullet hole, if he had sprayed the wall with bullets or, you know, fired bang, 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 that would have been reckless.
And the jury was concerned police went to the wrong home, that there was confusion.
That wasn't explained very well. And that was a sticking point for most of us.
The jurors honed in on the red beams on Watson's chest.
The police kept saying that they had their weapons pointed at the ground at all times. At the same time, they said they were using their tack lights on the gun to illuminate whatever they were looking at, which you can't be doing both at the same time.
Could a light have gone into the window? Yes. But I don't think it was there for any long period of time. It would have been a moving type of situation.
So when Mr. Watson says a red laser ended up on his chest, that's possible?
It's possible, sure.
And that's what led to the shooting?
That's when he discharged his firearm.
The Watson case has helped change Portsmouth police policy with the use of red gun laser sights.
This case and the firearms instructor's concerns, as well as executive staff, that we modified it and we've taken lasers off the weapons.
Most stunning, the jury found police were unfair in how they pursued Watson.
He was put in a no-win situation.
For Brandon Watson, his life turned upside down. Was unemployed for 10 months.
No jobs would hire me after they ran the criminal background because it's reckless handling with firearm.
That's what he said. No jobs. Everything ended at that point. Brandon Watson is pursuing legal remedies to what happened to him that night. One thing's for sure. Chances are, before tonight, you probably did not know Brandon Watson. But you sure would have known him had his bullet been a few inches to the right or left, hitting that police officer.
Nearly 5 years after Hurricane Katrina, federal prosecutors have charged a white man with federal hate crimes for his role in the racially motivated shooting of three black men in the aftermath of the storm. The five-count indictment unsealed last week accuses Roland Bourgeois of plotting to defend his Algiers Point neighborhood in New Orleans from, quote, outsiders, including African Americans, and shooting and seriously wounding Donald Harrington. Marcel Alexander and Chris Collins, who are walking toward a temporary evacuation center. A joint reporting project by the Times-Picayune, ProPublica, and PBS Frontline interviewed people this year who implicated Bourgeois in the shooting. Terry Benjamin was an eyewitness to the shooting and told reporter A.C. Thompson what she saw and heard on September 1st of 2005.
I want you to tell me about the incident that occurred in your neighborhood a couple days after the storm hit.
I heard the gunshot. So we started running towards my house because I had family in the house and we didn't know what, you know, that gunshot was all about, if everybody was okay. And we ran up and my neighbor was jumping up and down, hooting and hollering like he was big game hunting and he got the big one. And all of his friends were rallying him on and they were cheering. And he screamed, "I got one." And I went to him and I said, "What? Got one what?" And he said, "A looter." One of his friends comes running up the street and said, "You got one, but he ain't dead yet." And he proceeded to run with no shoes on around the corner wherever this man was laying down. After I asked him, I said, "Roland, you don't have to kill him. He's already down, just leave him alone. He's gonna die anyway, just leave him alone." And he said, "I'm gonna kill that nigger." And he went around that corner and we heard the shot. I didn't see him shoot him, but I felt it. When he came back from shooting that man the second time, he, at that point, got this adrenaline rush in him and he turned into somebody that I knew I couldn't negotiate with very much further. He turned into an animal. It was like he got the taste of blood and he was out for more. And I went to him and asked him to spare my cousin and my uncle's life, who were African American, that would be walking up that street. And at that point, I knew it wasn't safe for anything not white to walk up that street. And my neighbor looked at me and said, "Darling, anything coming up that street darker than a brown paper bag is getting shot."
Target is under fire after a local woman says she was racially profiled and forced to strip to prove she didn't steal a bathing suit.
7 Action News reporter Bethany Moore spoke with her and shows you what she's demanding tonight.
That Southfield woman says she's speaking out now because she wants Target to be held responsible and wants to make sure that this never happens to another woman again.
When I left, I was scared to leave, scared to drive my own car home.
Ashanae Davis describes the moments she tried to understand what she says happened to her on May 22nd.
At first, I was in shock, of course, and it was just very humiliating, and I felt degraded. It was sad. I was very upset.
She says she was at a Southfield Target when she tried to leave, and a plainclothes loss prevention officer stopped her, saying she stole a bikini. Another officer joined, and she was cuffed and taken to a room in the back of the store. It was in that room that Ashanae says the unthinkable happened.
To obtain her freedom, she then has to pull up her shirt in front of two male employees at Target to prove that she has not actually stolen a bikini top, and then she has to pull down her pants to prove that she has not stolen a bikini bottom. And only then would they let her leave Target.
She's now looking into legal claims against Target, including race and gender discrimination.
Someone needs to be held accountable for what happened, and it shouldn't happen to anyone else.
Ashanae says until this is resolved, she won't go back.
Definitely not.
She says if Target doesn't make the changes that she requests, then she will go through that lawsuit. Bethany Moore, 7 Action News.
Well, we just got this statement from Target, and it says, quote, "We want everyone who shops at Target to feel welcomed and respected and take any allegations of mistreatment seriously. We're sorry for the actions of our former team member who created an experience we don't want any guest to have at Target. We terminated the team member who was directly involved and are addressing the situation with our security team and the store."
Target under fire again this week with more claims of racial profiling at a local store.
Last week, a woman announced she was seeking legal action after allegedly being forced to strip to prove she did not steal a bathing suit.
Today, another woman came forward accusing the same Target of manhandling her until she proved she didn't steal.
7 Action News reporter Bethany Moore spoke with these women and their lawyers today. So, Bethany, what are they saying now?
Well, they say they don't want an apology from Target. They want policy change. Now, we do want to let you both know that we looked into both of these women, and neither of them so far have filed a police report, and this lawsuit has not yet been filed in court. Members of the community and supporters of the victims walked in wearing shirts with Target written on them.
Various members of the community who wanted to just show that we will not submit to being targets by Target.
The latest alleged target, Erica Anderson, who says back in November she was trying to leave the Southfield Target when she was stopped by a loss prevention officer and accused of stealing. She said he manhandled her, leaving bruises, and was only released after showing a supervisor her receipt.
I was very agitated, hurt, confused. I had a lot of emotions going through my head. I just couldn't understand what was going on.
Last week, Ashanae Davis spoke out publicly, saying she had been racially profiled in May when she claims a loss prevention officer told her to take off her clothes to prove she didn't steal a bikini.
I couldn't believe that this had happened to someone else at the same exact Target.
Lawyers Jasmine Rand and Maurice Davis say since last week, they have had more than 6 people reach out to them complaining about the Southfield Target and more than 30 people with complaints nationwide about Target discrimination.
I feel much better that I'm not standing alone on this. I'm very thankful for Erica coming up and speaking up and for whoever else has a story to tell.
In regards to Ashanae's situation, Target released a statement saying they were sorry and have fired that team member. The lawyers say that's not enough.
Sorry is a sorry word. We want to see some action. We want to see change in your policies.
Now we reach out to Target regarding Erica Anderson's specific situation. They have not yet responded to us. We also want to let you know, so the lawyers say that they have not yet filed that lawsuit in court just yet. They're right now in the process of just gathering information for future legal action.
A Tulare County man says an Atascadero police officer unlawfully questioned him because he's black. KSBY News reporter Angel Russell joins us now live from the police department where that interaction took place last year. Angel, what exactly happened?
Yeah, Dan, the man's name is Kyle Bell from Visalia, and according to this lawsuit, he had just spent the day in Morro Bay with his family, visiting here in San Luis Obispo County, and on his way back, he decided to take a break right in front of the police station in this parking space, and that is when an officer approached him and started questioning him. Well, according to this lawsuit, that was a racially motivated questioning, but the police department is denying any wrongdoing. We do have the video camera footage for you to view and for you to be the judge.
The Atascadero Police Department is being sued by a Visalia man who says he was racially profiled by an officer in October 2016.
The video kind of speaks for itself. Please view the video and take from it what you will.
The 3-minute and 17-second body cam video provided by police shows Officer Rochelle Hansen standing in the department parking lot speaking to a man below about his wife in the front seat.
Well, you just standing outside to smoke or? Okay. Can you tell her to roll her window down so I can make sure she's good?
What's the issue?
I just want to make sure that everything's okay. It's just a little weird, so.
Kyle Bell explains he just left Morro Bay after a day on the beach with his wife and kids.
Can you have her open the door really quick? I just explained why.
After some more back and forth, the officer walks to her police car.
You want to be a jerk about it.
Then drives around and parks behind Bell's family SUV and walks up when Bell's wife rolls down the window.
I just want to make sure everything was okay because I saw you sitting in the car with the windows up. I didn't see the child. And I saw him standing here at your door with the window up and the door closed. I did not see him smoking.
Oh, yeah.
So I want to make sure everything's cool.
No,
so,
okay.
Okay, excellent. That's all, dude. It was easy. Thank you.
Bell's attorney, Matthew Odom, says the officer questioned Bell because of the color of his skin.
He was perceived as a threat, as an outsider, as someone who should be challenged.
The lawsuit characterized Atascadero as a, quote, sundown town with historical official hostility to interracial relationships.
And if we kind of look honestly into ourselves, I think everyone can kind of discern what that reason was. And the reason was it's because he was a black man, where there aren't very many black people, if any.
According to the 2016 census, African Americans make up 2% of Atascadero's population. The police department is fighting the claims in the lawsuit.
We do have policies in place to ensure that our officers, the men and women that are out there doing their job, are doing them right and doing them with respect to all persons.
Bell's attorney tells me he believes this police department has a long history of making racially motivated stops. Chief Haley tells me that he can't go into details on the accusations or the video due to this pending litigation.
Child is crying here because of the video that's going on social media. Go ahead. You want to smile for the camera? Let's smile. Pull out your phone. You want to record me? I'm recording you. Pull out your phone.
Shame on you. Now why don't you go tell them that?
You brought your dog here to bite my child. Shame on you. Shame on you. Shame on you.
Did you just say I brought?
Yes, you
my
did.
Dog
your
bite?
Dog came around my child. You did
ma'am?
Not even come to take the dog
ma'am?
Away from my child.
Ma'am, you know that's a lie.
You brought
she just said I brought my dog
stop.
To bite. No,
stop.
She's
stop.
Crazy. She is crazy.
You're crazy.
I'm absolutely crazy.
See? See? Good. You just hit me, right? You just hit me, right? You just hit me.
And I have that on camera, too. Thank you.
God.
Yeah, bye. Crazy. Shame on you.
Here's my biting dog.
Shame on you. Go.
This
you are the biting dog. Go. Go. Go inside your house.
Your child.
Go inside your house. You want to come to talk to me? You want to come and talk to me? Pull out your phone. You want to record me? You brought your dog around my child. Let me tell you something. Are you a mother? Are you a mother?
Yes,
you have
sir,
children? All right. Well, then you need to have some respect for my child. You brought a dog, I don't know, around my child.
You think this
you brought this? I don't care. I don't know your
don't,
dog.
Don't do the innocent thing.
I don't know your dog.
Are you, here's gonna, the dog. Here's whoa, the whoa, big whoa. Biter. Here's the bug.
Excuse me. You're invading my private. Look.
Here you go. All right. Yeah. Good. Got it. What's your name?
I'm gonna get the license. Yeah, get the license plate.
Look at what you're doing. Look at what you're doing.
Okay.
And you have brought these people.
Victim.
You came up to us, first of all.
And you hit my phone twice. There you go. Go ahead.
Moving the stuff. This is
my property.
That's fine.
No, it is not your property.
This is my property.
Yes.
You're messing
with
stuff.
And I am moving
stuff.
Your property.
We will move. Don't worry. We'll move back. We'll move back.
You're racist. You are racist. Shame on you. Shame on you. You're racist. Racist. Shame on you.
You didn't tell them that.
Shame.
What's bothering you? You look so...
I don't like his arrogance. I think No, sir.
You look like a nigger talking like it. The white people.
Oh, I bet. Listen, I beg your pardon. No.
I don't want to. All black people don't cut up what you're saying. You mean white people know. Listen, woman, everybody black watching this show knows why you don't like the way I talk. You look like a nigger talking to you like this. Niggas never done nothing like this.
Sir,
before.
I know what it is.
Don't tell me what you don't like.
I beg your pardon.
You don't know who you're talking
to. I'm telling you what I don't like.
I don't care what you don't like. Just buy a ticket and see me get my butt whooped.
No. Listen, I'm in a minority in this country here.
What's your minority? What are you?
I'm from England.
You're a minority. You're from England. You own England and America. You white. You can go into any city you want to go. Oh, you from England. You more freer than me. You from England. Didn't you say you're a minority? You know you can go to towns, move in neighborhoods. You can buy things over. You can open a business downtown Chicago and do business, and I can't do it, but you from England. Now, you got some nerve to come over and be mad at me because I'm proud and I want to fight and be confident and get my people to be proud and fight and do. We the minority, too. We've been a minority for 400 years, and you freer than me. You from England.
No, I'm not.
You are freer than me, and everybody know you. How many of you white people here truly believe that she's not as free as me or any black man? She can open up a shop downtown. He can't even rent a store. You can. Don't compare yourself with no black man.
Okay. You want to talk about the peace thing? I'm sorry.
You got to be out your mind, lady.
She's a woman, though. Which
whatever she is, she's a white woman, and she's in a white society. I'm not getting on that. The woman is more free than all black people in Chicago.
Well, I don't know about that.
Well, I know about it, and you're a hypocrite. You think she ain't.
All right, and we back on the forecast. And I want to say RIP to Larry Jackson Jr., to the sister Tamla Horsford, and all our people who had their lives taken. We are at war. We didn't start this war. And it's not anything new. It's been going on for hundreds of years. And it's up to us to continue the fight our ancestors had. We are the generation that will get us over the hill. But we have to develop the right mindset and get on code. You can't change the system from within the system. You have to build your own. And you have to be ready to protect it when they come, because they are going to come to try to destroy it. We have to do whatever we have to do to put our children in a position to where they can prosper and teach them how to maintain it and how to protect themselves in the future from whatever enemy may come. The worst thing that could happen is for us to get on code and spread that mindset of liberty or nothing. Now, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And as always, man, we have got to start standing for something, or we're going to keep falling for anything.